These are acts of criminal violence and show utter disregard for human life and the laws of the world as well as its religions. Islam denounces their warmongering, murderous endeavors, and we deplore their incitement of crime. The Quran is a book of guidance. It is not a doctrine of violence.
The criminal acts that we have seen this week in Canada reflect on the individuals that committed them and not on a community.
Those spreading a message of violence to Canadians should know that the Muslim communities of Canada are devoted to battling their propaganda, and because their terrorism threatens the very well-being of Islam and Muslims in Canada, we stand in solidarity with Canadian authorities against all terrorism. Respected brothers and sisters, dear members of the press, good morning, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. On behalf of the BC Muslim Association, I would like to read the following statement to you. We as an association and as a community denounce the attacks on the soldiers on Monday, October 20th, as well as the attack on Parliament Hill on Wednesday, October 22nd. These are acts of criminal violence and show utter disregard for human life and the laws of the world as well as its religions. We openly condemn the propaganda of the lawless groups trying to incite Canadians to hurt other Canadians. Such propaganda is clear evidence that these groups or individuals are sheer terrorists. Whatever cause or mission they subscribe to is blackened by their methods. They have no real religion and no country. Islam denounces their warmongering, murderous endeavors, and we deplore their incitement of crime. We know that Canadian Muslims realize the fallacy of this call to violence and hope that youth are alert and aware of the criminal nature of such acts. Anyone who believes that carrying out attacks on Canadian soil is some form of jihad or an act of religious virtue has either misunderstood or perverted the teachings and texts of Islam and is blind to stark realities and facts. Canada welcomes Muslims, allows them the freedom to practice religion, and offers them all the facilities, amenities, opportunities, and security enjoyed by all its citizens. While causing senseless damage and destruction, such acts do great harm to Muslims themselves, and the perpetrators must carry the burden of tarnishing the image of Islam, creating misunderstandings and possibly animosity for Islam and Muslims, pushing non-Muslims away from the religion and making it difficult for Muslims to practice. The Quran is a book of guidance. It is not a doctrine of violence. The Prophet Muhammad, like all other prophets, peace be upon them, was sent to guide people to the path of God, not fighting them away. Any act of criminal violence has no place in our society. And individuals or groups who wish to instill terror in the hearts of Canadians by attacking Canadian civilians, institutions, infrastructure, and especially those devoted to protecting other Canadians have no place in Canada. Those spreading a message of violence to Canadians should know that the Muslim communities of Canada are devoted to battling their propaganda, and because their terrorism threatens the very well-being of Islam and Muslims in Canada, we stand in solidarity with Canadian authorities against all terrorist movements. We acknowledge the fact that the perpetrator of the attacks on Wednesday did attend this mosque for some period of time. This has already come out in the mainstream media. He did visit this mosque and pray here for a period of about 3 to 4 months, sometime in 2011 and perhaps the beginning of 2012. He was described as an individual who kept largely to himself. He had some questions or objections against the administration of this mosque, against the openness by which they were operating the mosque. He had some objection to the frequent visits by non-Muslims. The mosque administration sat him down and explained to him that this is how they will run the mosque. They will keep their doors open to all Muslims and non-Muslims who wish to visit. They also explained to them, to him, that the mosque operates on a foundation of welcome, of community outreach and interfaith dialogue, and that cannot take place when we close the doors on our neighbors. And if he was not okay with that, he should probably choose another mosque to go to and pray. After some time, while he was going through trouble with the law and in and out of jail, he tried to use the mosque as a place of accommodations for himself. The caretakers of the mosque identified him and they warned him not to try to sleep here. He did not listen to that warning. This happened two or three times, and at one occasion they actually caught him sleeping. At that time he was told to leave the premises, not to sleep here again, and not to come back here again. And at that time the locks of the mosque were all changed. This was the last sort of interaction that the people of the mosque here have had with him. Some have said that they saw him here last year. I know there are reports of more recent sightings of him here at this mosque. We cannot confirm that from our side. To move on, there is a program that we have been working on and have been speaking with Canadian authorities about, as well as government representatives. This is a preventative program to educate Muslims and non-Muslims about the actual teachings of Islam as opposed to the radical version portrayed by groups like ISIS. The program will be a broad program aiming not only to educate but also to create awareness, to create an environment of non-acceptance to such kinds of criminal violence. And we hope in the process of this campaign or program to collaborate with the authorities, with government institutions, as well as other community groups. We hope to pull together our ideas, our resources, and energies to try to diminish the possible effects of propaganda coming from outside. We plan on maximizing the use of online resources, social media, and every other tool that we have to our access. And we look forward to moving forward with this program very quickly in the near future. Thank you very much.
Everyone, my name is Assistant Commissioner Wayne Rideout. I am a Criminal Operations Officer with the British Columbia RCMP, and I'm responsible for, amongst other areas, national security and counterterrorism. Thank you to the BC Muslim Society for our ability and their willingness for us to participate with them here today. The criminal acts that we have seen this week in Canada reflect on the individuals that committed them and not on a community. The BC RCMP National Security Program has been working with the BC Muslim community, including the BC Muslim Association, since 2005 through its community outreach program. An RCMP National Security Community Outreach Initiative is a comprehensive effort to engage all of Canada's ethnic, cultural, and religious communities in the protection of Canada's national security. The effective protection of Canada's national security requires the awareness and active engagement of all citizens and is a shared responsibility. The BC RCMP is continuing to monitor the evolving situation taking place in Ottawa. We, along with our law enforcement partners and our community partners, are continually assessing potential threats in British Columbia and adjusting the security needs accordingly. While there are no current identified threats in our province, we encourage everyone to be vigilant or report any suspicious activity to their local police departments. Thank you.
Good morning. Assalamu alaikum. My attendance here today is to show my strong support for this mosque and members of this mosque as part of our community. As the officer in charge of the Burnaby RCMP, we take very seriously the role to keep all of our community members safe, including members of faith-based institutions. I would also like to reiterate what was already said this morning, and from a personal level, I have been in this room many times. I've been in here recently for a community safety forum. And when it's said that the mosque is open to Muslim and non-Muslim members of our community, that's true. I personally experienced that, as I said, on a couple of occasions. And we've been working with the mosque and members of this mosque for several years, beginning in 2004.
Please repeat.
As I was saying, Mr. Rashid, I'm just wondering, Mr. Pipo's comments about not wanting non-Muslims, what was his tone, what was he talking about? Did you report any of those problems that you were having with him to the RCMP?
Well, as far as his comments or objections were concerned, I cannot confirm the tone by which he stated them, but there was no criminal implication in that, in those questions themselves. He obviously wanted the mosque reserved for Muslims only. The administration sat him down and explained the nature of the mosque and its operations, and that this was how it was going to continue to operate. And after that, they did not experience any problems from him in that regard or any further questions. In fact, when they outlined to him that he could go to another congregation if he so wished, he chose to stay here for the time that he was around and did not object anymore. So there was no cause of alarm or of reporting anything to the authorities.
Has the tragedy in Ottawa...
Just need your name, need your... media group, please.
Okay, me, Jung Lee, CTV. Has the shooting in Ottawa changed how you will report any suspicious activity? Will you be more likely to report things because of what has happened?
The law enforcement agencies have outlined for us what are the things they're looking for and what kinds of things we need to report. If that changes from their side, then our collaboration also will evolve with that, and we'll continue working with them on these lines.
Commissioner Ryla, David Fitzpatrick with CNN. Can you please tell us what you know about Mr. Pipo's movements here in Vancouver, as far as you know that we know he was, of course, brought to the court for the charge in late 2011, and was moved to a different charge in 2012. What about after that? What can you tell us about his movements? What have we learned?
Well, I'm sure as you can appreciate, we are somewhat limited in the details that we can provide. This investigation is being run at a national level from our national headquarters in Ottawa. The British Columbia RCMP and its policing partners here in BC are actively participating in that investigation and currently collecting information in support of that effort. I can confirm, that, as you have stated, that we did spend time in British Columbia, and those the details of which are forming part of a large national investigation, and it really would not be appropriate for me to start divulging that information at this time until it is properly correlated and come together with the remainder of the information that exists and being held in Ottawa.
One quick follow-up question. Can you tell us, if you know, how did the EF represent food to Ottawa? Bus, train, car, what were his movements like?
I can tell you that those facts are being investigated thoroughly by the British Columbia RCMP and the National RCMP, but I'm not in a position to give that information at this time.
Dominique Arnoldi, Radio-Canada, Monsieur Rachid en français, s'il vous plaît. Quelles sont vos craintes suite à la fusillade de mercredi? Et est-ce que vous serez plus enclin à dénoncer rapidement, rapporter à la police des choses qui vous paraissent suspicieuses?
Well, as I mentioned...
En français, est-ce que c'est possible?
Is English okay?
It's okay, we've got the answers.
Rachel Kirk, the Associated Press. Is there any idea or knowledge that there's been communication between Michael and another former attendee here who is now going to be in the Middle East? And can you talk at all about any relationship or concerns about having two former attendees now under having a license to serve in this case?
Well, I'm much in the same position. Every single rock will be turned over with respect to this investigation. We will examine every aspect of the suspect's activities, contacts. We will examine every individual that he may have come in contact with that may be connected to this crime. So all of those things, and specifically previous contact, will be the subject of detailed examination. But at this time, we are not in a position to provide those details to you until we have the investigation completed. And as you said, the BC RCMP and its police departments here are conducting an investigation in support of national level.
But Mr. Rashid, can you speak to the to Mr. Yusuf Singh, who previously been at this hospital?
Specifically,
any knowledge of him or concerns, similar concerns, similar to the experiences you've had with Mr.
I personally do not know too much about Mr. Yusuf Singh. What we know is basically what we read in the media ourselves, or as the law enforcement agencies made their inquiries, certain things came to light. Beyond that, it's difficult to comment. We do know that at some point he was asked to leave this mosque because of certain views he was expressing. That much we do know. I don't have the details of that, of what exactly he was saying, but the mosque administration did confirm to us that they had asked him to leave and not come if he was going to have extremist views and try to share them with the congregation.
So did you report that to the authorities at the time then?
That has been brought to the attention of the authorities.
It's Chris Brown with CDC. Can you tell me more about this anti-propaganda plan that you're going to be working on with the RCMP? That there's two names, two big international stories associated with this mosque with a bad, obviously bad overtone. So I want to know really what more are you going to do?
We had a meeting actually this past Saturday in which we addressed the potential threat of someone responding to the ISIS propaganda. And the idea was to engage law enforcement as well as government representatives and try to get as much cooperation from them as possible. And a plan was proposed. It's a comprehensive plan. Some of the features of it are to prevent Canadians from involvement in violent criminal activities in Canada or abroad, to discourage individuals who are considering involvement in such activities, and to dissuade individuals who are already involved or perceiving themselves to be involved. The scope of this would be to address religious or ideological radicalization leading to criminal violence, as well as gang and organized criminal violence. The stakeholders in this would be primarily Public Safety Canada, its agencies and partners, faith and ethnic-based groups, educators at the secondary and post-secondary levels, and municipal, provincial, federal government representatives, social services, and any other institutions that could be involved. Now, there are numerous components. There's the educational component of this, which would mean holding programs, seminars, conferences at educational institutions like our universities and colleges, in which we open up some of these topics to the youth and allow them to ask questions from an Islamic perspective, explaining actual Islamic teachings versus what is being projected. Also, from a public safety perspective, having officials come in and explain their concerns and how people can contribute towards creating a safer environment here in Canada. So that's just one component of it. Compiling literature, using social media, forming websites, blogs, creating a zeal inside youth to counter this at that levels where they can probably more effectively reach youth than we can or the institutions can, encouraging them to create such projects in schools through their teachers and through the arts and through whatever activities youth are involved in to create this sort of a non-acceptance of criminal violence in a general sense and specifically in the sense that we are experiencing this last week. It also involves having workshops focused at specific groups, involves using TV media, and these are some of the salient features of the proposed preventative program.
Can I just maybe add to that? I think that it's important to recognize that there have been efforts ongoing in Canada with our community and policing partners for a number of years on what we refer to as community outreach, and these efforts, of course, have evolved and respond to the evolution of the kind of threat that we see. I can also tell you that around the world, our our international partners face the same issues and concerns, and our health programs of varying degrees around community outreach and understanding the threat early. That, in my view, the real challenge and the highest way, the greatest way we will be successful is around the early engagement of people who are potentially susceptible to becoming self-radicalized, particularly now with the ease of this information coming to them through the internet and through social media. And it becomes everybody's responsibility, everybody's problem to understand how that threat is being received by vulnerable persons and to become engaged in a tremendous opportunity to try to de-escalate that evolution.
So I take it from your comments, your belief is that this is more a case of people self-radicalizing and then coming here, or being radicalized here and then going out?
Well, I guess I would have to ask you what you mean by this case. So we have seen in Canada people that have become self-radicalized, and we have seen people that have been inspired by others. So I think all exist, as our policing partners around the world have seen. What I think is really important is that, as is taking place here today, our community partners, parents, all of you become aware of the potential issue, and that we are noticing when people are vulnerable to becoming radicalized, and that we become involved and aware of that at a very early stage. Because at the end of the day, our ultimate goal should be to stop that, protect them, particularly our youth who are vulnerable to radicalization due to, you know, vulnerability that occurs when people are young. We need to become involved early. We need to strengthen our programs and our community partnerships around ensuring that they do not become vulnerable to this type of extremist thing.
Mr. Rashid, Marcello Bernardo from CKNW. I can't help noticing that there's heavy security coming into this building. There's gates that lock, there's video surveillance cameras. Have you had instances in the past where you've been vandalized, or why is it that there is such tight security coming in here?
For some time now, we have been advised by the law enforcement officials to keep an eye out on our facilities and make sure that they're secure. And it's been several years now that all the BCMA facilities have pretty solid security systems and cameras and all of those things. And this is not something that has come about immediately. It's actually a little bit old now.
I wonder if I could possibly add to that as well. As I indicated earlier, we've been working very closely with the mosque, as we do with all our community partners. And this is not new in the sense of, when you talk about video surveillance, I would suggest that's a part of business. For any business or homeowners, you see dash cams on cars. When you talk about security, I would like to reiterate what was said previously, is this is a place of worship that is, in my personal experience, been open on numerous occasions to Muslims and non-Muslims alike. And in this very room, we have had a community safety forum that was hosted by this mosque with our support for all members of our community, not just members of this mosque. And we talked about those things that you just raised, about security as it relates to everybody in our community.
Mr. Rashid, a
quick
follow-up from CNN. Were the video images that used to be both captured on our security cameras, and if so, have we given them to the authorities?
We do not have, to my knowledge, cameras, video tapes of him in this mosque.
Mr. Rashid, Chester Bassam with the Wall Street Journal. Could you provide a timeline of when Mr. Yusufzai was praying at this mosque, how recently was he here? And secondly, are you aware of anyone who is currently attending this mosque, or anyone else, I should say, currently attending or has attended in the past with radical tendencies that you've discussed with the RCMP?
I think the case of Mr. Yusufzai is that he used to pray here perhaps 2 or 3 years ago. And I don't have an exact time frame of how frequent that was or what months that was in. We have not really had any issues about people from this mosque specifically being radicalized or sharing radical types of ideologies with others.
Seeing we are coming to an end.
So actually, can you tell us how real is the propaganda? Is there active propaganda in this in North Mainland that you can say that the threat is real?
I don't think the propaganda is restricted to any specific part of Canada. It's online. It's there for whoever chooses to access it, and whoever is susceptible to it. I think, based on what I've been reading in the news, there are online forums, there are social media platforms being used, there are propaganda videos being used through YouTube and whatnot, and anyone who is anywhere in the world has access to this and is potentially susceptible to receiving this message. That's one of the elements that makes it a little bit harder to put our fingers on exactly where it's coming from and who is it reaching, who is it not reaching.
CBC French National Television. If you back in your preventive program, you said you had a meeting last Saturday. Have you had it? Because from what I look, it looks like you're going to need approval from provincial federal government. Is it something on which you've been working for a while, or was it the first meeting last week?
Last week was our first official meeting in this regards, and now we're just moving forward. We've already started discussions with officials at various levels. We are seeing a fair amount of cooperation, and we hope that we can sort of get this thing started as soon as possible.
Mr. Rashid, there was a mosque in Alberta that was vandalized overnight. Has this mosque, or any mosques in BC, received any threats about any sort of retribution? I use that word, not the right word.
We have, in the past, as well as in the very recent past, this week received some threats, and whenever that happens, we report it to the authorities, and we take their advice on how to act.
But have you received any threats after these attacks?
Yes, we have.
What was the nature of those threats?
It was more general towards Muslims or their religion or their places of prayer, and the idea was to sort of create this fear that you're not safe from us, from whoever these people are.
And how were those threats communicated? Phone, email, social media?
Mainly through emails.
Yes. A quick follow-up, Mr. Rashid, Christina, I'm sorry. Did you personally meet Mr. Bebo? Have you personally met him and talked to him on any of these occasions in the past, in 2011 or 12?
No, I've never come across him personally.
Can you also tell me about
Commissioner, just a follow-up to what you were saying earlier about when first, there were some issues with the mosque. I'm bringing a day on local television. You said in the beginning when he was coming to the mosque, there were some issues as far as he didn't want anybody that was non-Muslim to be here, and then some of his talk escalated. He didn't go into detail about that. At that point, you said that you did talk to RCMP about Mr. Peebles. At any time, did you call the RCMP about him?
No, there was no need to call the RCMP. He was not doing anything criminal or anything of that sort.
He never threatened anybody. He was making threats in general.
I think it should be noted, the whole entire BC Muslim Association has a very open door policy that must be understood, as reiterated by our RCMP friends, that that's the nature of the operation we run. We welcome everybody. This is a mosque, like any other church. You know, you're welcome to come, observe, and participate if you wish. So in that regard, we are not out there checking each individual who's coming and going. People come and go. Out of thousands of people who have come and attended our mosque over the last 47 years, the BC Muslim Association mosques, this is two incidents that we know of, which happens to be, coincidentally, at this mosque. And that's the sad part that happened in this mosque. Other than that, we don't have any such incident of this nature in any other location.
Thank you.
So that should also be seen as a positive way of welcoming, interacting, working with interfaith groups, working with the law enforcement, and welcoming school children to come and understand about Islam. It's been ongoing for years and years and years. So we are going to continue to do that, and hopefully with the support of the media as well as RCMP, we will progress in a positive way rather than take this as a negative situation and let's lock up the doors. That is not the intent. So we're going to continue to be open, welcome everybody to come and partake.
Was that 2-3 years ago when he was here or more recently?
I don't think it's appropriate to say exactly when I spoke to them, but inquiries were being made about him. That has come out to the public, and there were concerns about him. And we, as a community, tried to offer whatever support we could in that investigation.
Yes, but it was not the defense CBC. What signs would you look for, and what would you do when you see?
What we have been advised by the RCMP is that if there is an act of criminal violence or something that indicates that an act of criminal violence is going to take place, or someone has expressed an intent to carry out an act of criminal violence, all of these are signs of concern.
How about what they say?
Well, if it falls under any of those things, to propagate criminal violence or such an act of terrorism, for example, this is included in that. But the expression of an ideology, the expression of an opinion, which may differ from the mainstream opinion, that by itself is not something illegal. And it should not be looked at something illegal. It's part of what makes us a democratic society and a free society. But there are specific things that we have been told to look out for, and when that happens, these are warning signs.
If I could add to that, I would agree wholeheartedly with those comments. I mean, that is what is great about our society, that people have the right to believe, have their own beliefs and their own thoughts. What I think we are talking about is people who are following a path of extremism towards criminal behavior. They're taking their thoughts into a very extreme place, and they're transiting their thoughts into actions. And that is the point and the nexus from their ability to enjoy the freedoms that we all have in Canada into the criminal environment. So I think what we need to look for, and what are changes in behavior that are sudden and out of the norm, and that they begin to act in a way that is different, that they tend to espouse the use of violence or extreme activity in support of their beliefs. Perhaps they talk about specific individuals in a negative way, where they seem to have a fixation on particular agencies, institutions, or individuals, where they tend to acquire skills and or perhaps weapons. And those are the things, and those are the obvious things that start to move a person's behavior from what is a legal right in Canada into that criminal behavior. And that is the apex of what we're looking for to become engaged and to understand who they are. You know, what is being actioned in different places around the world is contrary to the freedoms that we enjoy in this country, and it's contrary to the rule of law. What we want to promote and not lose sight of is that that we operate under the rule of law, and that we enjoy rights and freedoms, and we have to reiterate amongst the communities, and particularly those people who are vulnerable to extremism, that they are going well beyond what the very rights they seek to enjoy when they start moving into the criminal domain.
How seriously are you taking the...
causing problems here, breaking into the mosque, and among other things. But then you said that you didn't personally speak to him. And yesterday I spoke with David Ismail. He said he hasn't met him either. Who was the leader who actually dealt with him at that time?
These are officials of the previous administration of this mosque. The administration has changed since then. So people that were here and active in 2011 are the people that dealt with him and interacted.
Do you have any names that you could give us?
I'm afraid I can't give you those names.
They're no longer officials of this. So, and this last question.
Commissioner, how seriously are you taking these threats aimed at the mosque?
Well, we're going to take all threats seriously, and we would like to reiterate that these activities that we've seen are not related to a community or religion. These are acts of individual people who have become criminal as a result of their beliefs. So, you know, we are looking for people to appreciate and understand that, but we will conduct investigations into any activity that takes place that represents hatred towards any religious institution, and we will take it very seriously.
So as a last comment, you must have gathered that we were already working on preventative measures to be taken to avoid such incidents in any of our mosques. So we had the meeting last Saturday in cooperation with RCMP. So that action is going to continue, and hopefully we will not have such incidents in the future. That's our wish, and I know it's the wish of everybody. On that note, I'd like to say thank you for coming and participating and conveying the message on our behalf to the rest of the world in this case, and appreciate you being present here on behalf of the whole world, especially those who have been inflicted, and our condolences goes to all those families who have been affected in any way, especially those who have lost their loved ones. Thank you very much for coming, and hopefully you have a great day. Thank you.